I hope you had a good tea break, for feeling refreshed. And thanks for making it up. There was quite a big dust from outside. So, okay. So, I think let's start for the sake of time, and whosoever will have to join in will join in between. As Meetu has already briefed about the talk, it's all about lean tools that work. So, just a quick question before I start the talk. Is everyone aware of lean and its methodology and tools? Or no? Okay, so I will just quickly go through a few of the slides that just explains what lean is and what it is all about for the sake of everyone. Would that be fine? Okay. So this is a brief background of myself. I'm working as a director of product development at Pico Software. I have around 15 plus years of work experience. I'm more of in the technology. I did my BE in MTech IT and heading the web mapping solutions at PitneyBose, and also leading the agile operations of PitneyBose globally. Earlier, I was just leading the India initiatives, but now I have just taken the role of a global lead and heading all the regions at PitneyBose. So all the certifications, not just I'm a big fan of doing certifications. It's just that, you know, I have a constant urge to learn new things and learn more. And certification, I would say, just a byproduct of learning activities. Okay, so as I said, let's quickly cover what lean is all about. So lean, we say it's all about choices. Choices we make day in and day out. Choices we do make in our personal and professional life. So what is lean all about? It says we need to focus on the customer value. And how I will focus on the customer value? By recognizing the waste and continuously optimizing the processes. Now, when I say recognize waste, that means waste can be in the form of effort, time, or poor quality. Continuously optimize the processes can be a flexibility and the pace I take to deliver. I will quickly go through these slides to cover what lean is. Lean says it is like unleashing capacity. Many of our processes contain a dormant capacity, so we need to have various ways to optimize the process and see what best can be done to achieve to the fullest. So lean is not about working harder, working faster, or blaming people. It is just a form of recognizing waste and fine-tuning your processes. So today I'm going to tell you whatever tools that can be practically applied and we have seen in our own products and projects we have worked upon, that how it can be practically applied to identify whatever the forms of waste are. And then it is up to you what you do and what you apply to remove those. Now, it says, lean says that the forms of waste can be an excess inventory, it can be rework, it can be overproduction, overprocessing, delay, excess movement, and excess material. If you will look, these more are the terms of a production belt, because lean was actually, you know, developed at the Toyota, right? So we will see how it maps to the software development. So when I say excess inventory, it can be a big bang project that missed the target, or too much WIP, that is too much work in progress, right? Rework can be a false start, mistakes, bugs that we encounter while we are developing. Overproduction can be the 45% of the features never used. Overprocessing can be making features better than they have to be. Now, this is very interesting. How many of us have used Microsoft Word, Office? I think all of us have. And how many features you actually use? And I think in spite of so much of work experience that we all have, there will be 50% of Microsoft Word which you have never touched and which you have never used. But definitely efforts have been spent on developing those features, right? So this is around that we need not develop the features which are not going to be used by the customers at all. Because we have developers who have invested time. We have the company who have invested money to develop those features, right? So this is around that it can be an overproduction with the features which are never used by the customer. Overprocessing can be making features better than they have to be. I have a classic example of the project I worked upon in 2007, and it was the first project that we did the Agile way. And there was a developer, he's a very good developer, and he was always overboard with rework and refactoring. You always used to say, no, we need to do code refactoring, we need to make it better, the architecture is not proper. So always there used to be a PBI around refactoring, and he took ages and sprints in doing that refactoring. Not that a bad idea if you say it alone as a standalone thing, then we need to improve our code, we need to do refactoring, but not at the stake of missing the deadline, not at the stake of the product not going in the market on time. So I think that is something that is very well depicted by this line, making features better than they have to be, right? So you need to make your logical decisions at time. Delays can be waiting for inputs and decisions. I think most of the agile teams, if you go back and ask them, they say we are waiting for requirements from our product managers. So we need to find out how much time the teams are actually spending on getting the requirements and how much time they're actually doing on building the requirements. Whereas when we count the efficiency of a team, it is just counted at the output, the software when it is delivered. No one goes back and traces back and breaks into the point how much time was actually spent on waiting for the inputs and decisions. The excess movements can be the handoffs between the various processes and steps that take place. Excess material can be unused tools. There might be a lot of tools which we are not using. I think in these days, most of the companies do not have much, because if they are already into Agile, they either use Jira or Rally or others. But the companies who are in the transformation phase, there might be a lot of tools which are not used on a day-to-day basis. So what does the Lean principle say? It says identify what creates value for the customer, document the value stream, the things we do that generate value for the customer. So we will see a practical example of how we calculate value stream and value stream mapping and how it will help us to identify the waste. Is anyone aware of VSM already in the room? You are, okay. Then it might be a repeat for you, but that's fine. So please do add if at all you want to add anything for our business. Recognize the waste, standardize the process, enforce quality. I think all good lines, but we need to see how to do it, right? The practical ways. Now the tools that I'm going to talk today is around, one is value stream mapping. What kind of waste it recognizes? Rework, delays, and excess movement. The principle is we should recognize the waste in the system. Then we are going to deal with error proofing, which says enforce quality at the source. Defer commitments, again around enforce quality at the source. It just maps what lean principles all these tools are going to be attached to. Then standardized work and visual controls, problem solving, learning and continuous improvement. So we are going to do all those in detail, so I will just skip this slide. Now we say it's recognized waste, and so what is the standard definition of a waste? Waste can be anything that does not create value, right? So our waste for our one company might be very useful for the other, might be something useful for the customers of the other company. So it's all around, you need to identify what is the waste. Whatever doesn't create value for our customer is a waste in the system. Now it says, but who defines the value? It is the customer, the end customer. Now this is a slide, I think you all would have seen in your CSM trainings and all. It just depicts that how many features are actually percentage of features that generally are always or often used and never or rarely used. So this is based on a study that was done long back. It is around 64% of the features which are never used. That is the biggest waste in the system. And generally 20% of the features we develop are the ones which are used. And the classic example of it is, if you know, you would have seen a DVD remote control a few years back. So many, and it is such bulky with so many buttons on it that you really don't know what to do. And now it has been really simplified. I mean, and I think now it is just the few controls, rewind, forward, play, stop kind of buttons. So that is also an example of that they have just removed the features which were never used by the system. Now let's say, what are the developmental wastes that can be here? Waste can be partially done work. Why? Because it's obsolete, the value is unknown. Extra features. Why? We have already seen that why to spend time on developing something that our end customers are not going to use. Now this is a very nice quote by Jay Sutherland. It says, every line of code costs money to write and more money to support. I think the second half of it is very powerful, because how many times your developers say that there is so much of code in the system that we are not using and we are just adding on to the technical debt, right? And that is why refactoring becomes so difficult, because there is so much of code that needs to be refactored, which will never be used by the end customers. So he says it's better for developers to be surfing than writing code that won't be needed. So let's not spend time on seeing whether the people are actually working. And I think this mindset is slowly and gradually changing. Earlier, if you look around 6 to 7 years back, the project managers were like, ki, kuch to kaam de do inhe, you know, they should be busy with something. But I think these days, it is they are trying to move away from it, because it is really important to have something which is generating value for the customer. If you have lean time, spend time on training, spend time on personal learning and development rather than writing something which will never be used. Coming back to this slide, it says relearning. It can be making the same mistakes again. Handoffs. So do you, what is your opinion in the room, that does multitasking makes the system more efficient, or it makes the system inefficient? Because generally we have seen, and you know, with the programmers, multi-threading and multitasking is a way to go, right? What do you feel, it helps or it doesn't help?
I think it does.
It does? So how many of you feel it does help?
Are you talking about multi-threading in the application? Or
no,
in the
I'm
behavior?
Saying multitasking. I just use multi-threading. Yes, okay. Yeah.
Context switching is always
Yeah, apart from that, there's always a big problem of finding out, like, if you have three things to do,
yes,
then finding out which one is valuable, then it maybe, I mean, I'll be confused, like, should I spend more time in this and the other one? What if that, you know, other thing is asked for? Like, it's really confusing.
Right, so I think the research says that, you know, multitasking and context switching, it delays work rather than it's becoming, making things more efficient, right?
It depends on that point, what level you're at.
So at senior level, people don't do any tasks. they just think that, you know, we will say we are doing multitasking. Okay. So it is generally, I think I'm talking more at the ground level where, you know, where you are generating. See, if you are a manager and you are managing, you know, 6 teams, definitely you can say you are, you know, multitasker and your main thing is to improve. And it doesn't take time, so you're able to manage. But I think on the developer front, and you know, if you have 2-3 tasks you have taken in a sprint, it is just adding delays. So again, the same thing that I said, task switching is a loss of flow plus wasted resources. Delays, it says more opportunity for change and rework. Defects, again, these are the type of waste that are there. It can be extra processes, where unnecessary paperwork, poor communication, or management activities, a wasted effort and a lost focus. I think it is just going on, so I will just quickly go through it, because we will never be able to otherwise reach the VSM part of it. So this is the exercise I really wanted you to do, but we can skip it. You can just think of, you know, what kind of a waste that are there, and or you have heard from your team that are wasteful, and what you can do to, you know, remove. Any questions so far, just for now? So we're all clear of what lean is, what lean talks about, what are the examples of software development waste? Okay. So let's go straight away to our value stream mapping. So what does it do? It says it combines agile and lean concepts. Agile says you deliver value to your customer. Lean says eliminate waste by removing anything that is not valuable to the customer, right? Whether it is inefficiencies, extra processing, or unused stuff. We have seen lots of examples of it already. Fixing the process may not change the value delivered to a customer, but it will reduce the time it takes to get it to the customer. So this is very important to realize what VSM is going to bring you. Why we are going to do it? It makes the process visible and exposes the waste. So we say identify waste, right? Lean is all about, you know, eliminating the waste. But we need to have ways of how I should identify where the waste is there in the system. You're not just going to go with a magnifying glass and you'll be able to identify, yes, these are the things, you know, that I need to do. So this is a mechanism, and this is a tool by which waste can get surfaced, and you will come to know that this is where actually the delay is happening. This is where I can do something, or I can implement few processes where the efficiencies can be improved. Again, this is again important, since it replaces process emotion with process data. So in the sprints, you might say that QA takes a lot. lot of a time, you know, testing, it takes half of a sprint, and then QA get emotional. No, we are getting the code on the sixth day. How are you saying so? You know, it is just a 9-day sprint, it's just 2 days of work that I'm doing. So it says it is going to replace your emotions with data. So every time, you know, you talk to any VP or any senior leader, they say, please show me the data. I'm not bothered about your feeling and what do you feel that this team is efficient or this team is not efficient. Where is the data, right? So this is what it's going to tell you. Now, there are two things that you must know over here. Cycle time is the average end-to-end process time from problem deduction to problem solution, and it begins and ends with the customer. So this is, if you remember this tagline, it begins and ends with the customer. The cycle time is this. For example, the cycle time can be when a customer reported a problem and when the solution reached to the customer. So it might be, for example, that on today the customer raised something that he needs a solution for, and by another 13 July I gave him a solution. So all these 30 days is my cycle time, right? Begins and ends with the customer. As simple as that. And what is the software development cycle time? The speed at which a customer need is reliably and repeatedly translated into deployed software. So customer request to customer satisfied. This is our cycle time, right? Now it says this covers the big picture, and don't get bogged down with every detail. So we will just see how it does with an example.
Staying here, actually, you are talking about a maintenance project or a totally new project?
Any project.
But any project, cycle time for a new project is starting. It's a big one where probably the first deliverable will come after 1 year or 9 months or so.
Right.
You will say this, the value stream or the cycle time there is going to be 9 months minimum.
So again, it is again depends upon that where we are actually, see, for a new project altogether, you must have some historical data based on which you would have planned your new project. Maybe it is a team velocity or it is a similar type of a project. So we can use historical data in case of a new project to eliminate the waste at the first go itself, right? Okay, so what is the value stream map? It says tools used to evaluate the process to identify the bottleneck, waste and improvement. State the map that shows steps, delays and information flows. So I will read, I think it is very, very unreadable because of the lighting. So it says customer requests the product fix. It is 5 minutes. Support triages the request 2 hours. And the time from the customer request to the support, let us say, just 5 minutes, right? Then, even I'm unable to read it from that far off. It says dev team changes the request, adds to the queue, it is 1 hour. But from support to the dev team, it took 3 days, right? Then it takes 1 week for the dev to fix release in, you know, for 1 week for the dev to start fixing it, 2 weeks for them to fix it, right? Again, the customer deploys the fix pack in 1 hour, but it takes 2 weeks for the customer to get the fix. So this is all around, so that to make it more simple, the tasks are depicted in the boxes, and the time which is written below the boxes is the time actually spent on that task. And the time which is written beneath the arrows is the handoff time, right? From one task to the another. Now, what will be my value added time? Just the time in these boxes, right? This is the time actually spent on those, defect or fix or whatever. Total cycle time will be definitely the begin and the end, as I told. From the time the customer is till he gets the solution. So this is my process efficiency, a value added time over the total cycle time. Yes.
Will prioritization of item inefficient system, because there could be a feature that customer requested today, but because of other items which are prioritized probably above that feature gets implemented, let's say 3 months down the line, that increases your total cycle time as is, and that can potentially be called inefficient, but
so
might
let's
not.
Let's park this question. I have an answer. So let's park this question for a while. Let the people understand how it is calculated, and I will come back. So efficiency is value added time over the total cycle time. So we say that system is 27% efficient. Now, what can I do, you know, by overlooking this? I can ask, and there are other steps also. I can ask that, okay, this is 5 minutes, this is fine, this is 3 days, fair enough, based on, let us say, the prioritization of the things that developers do. 1 week, fine. But why, let us say, I may question that why it took 2 weeks for the things that were already ready to reach to the customer. Maybe here is something that I can do. But again, you will going to get that insight once you're going to ask why. There might be a reason for it. There might be, you know, the customer, you know, we were calling the customer was unavailable. Or we did deliver to the customer, but customer didn't deploy the fix for 2 weeks. It can be any reasons. But the thing is, once you go into value stream, and this you can apply in any of your process. Maybe it is a PBI. Maybe it is, you know, your requirements reaching from the product owner. You can have a VSM there as well. You know, that as you talked around the prioritization, so it can be applied anywhere. It is not just for your requirements. It can be it is just for process. It can be the time the product owner gets the requirement to the time he writes the user story in your tool, whether it is Jira or anything. Then you can plot a VSM for that. And you may be able to see after drawing that VSM that a requirement getting translated into a user story generally takes 1 and 2 months. So you can ask why. And it might be the reason comes out to be very usual that the product owner is multitasking, he has 6 products and he doesn't have time to write the user stories. But then it gives you the insight picture where you can find out ways of improvement. And where exactly the delay is happening, where exactly, how can I increase the efficiency of my system. And once I start to do a VSM for the processes, generally we start with the support cases. Generally you start with the pain point in the systems where it is. Wherever you think the delays are more, wherever you think your system is less efficient, you can do a VSM for that and try to find out. So simply just plot the tasks, just put the actual time spent in the boxes and just put the hand of time on the arrows. Right? Clear with it? So as you said, the prioritization of it. So there, it cannot be a usual activity that whenever you take up. So when I am going to do a VSM, I'm not going to take one of those cases. I'm going to take in general, you know, what is the general tendency of the system is, right? Is it clear? Any questions on that? This is another example. So I think we'll just quickly move ahead. So after mapping the current or as-is process, you look for the forms of waste in the process, map the future or to-be process that reduces the waste, finally launch a project to implement the to-be process. So it is mainly around that. This is another example I have taken. So again, I think we'll skip this exercise. What other things are there? It says anti-patterns and potential solutions. What can be anti-pattern is something which you do other than usual pattern that happens. What it can be? It can be you keep the backlogs to an absolute minimum, right? It can be make asynchronous if possible, otherwise try to shorten the cycle. Regular review or solution meeting. Callbacks, immediate communication. Slow approval cycles, you can use optimistic approval assumption, except rework if needed. In the sense that if, let us say, you are spending a lot of time in waiting for the approvals and somehow your company culture is such that it is not coming and you don't have a direct control on it, it maybe you want to start with the work and at times accept the rework if it is there, or you know, it might be that you don't get any, you know, rework. So these are few of the anti-patterns that I listed, which we can go through. Multiple sequential review or approval cycle, you can delegate it. Parallel activities with integration cost, you can make them sequential or streamlined. If you have wrong test cycles, you can separate the testing cycles from the debug. Focus on reduced technical debt or test automation. Sub-optimization, how you can do, you can link the value stream to customer at both the ends, trace all the way to customer in production. So these are the few anti-patterns which you can go through. So let's go, this is the example of Zara. I think you must be aware of it's a clothing store. It says Zara takes time from design to store in 2 weeks, and they take twice weekly orders, they deliver globally 2 days after the order. It's mainly what it depicts is more of a lean approach. They keep their stocks to the minimum and inventory at the minimum, and they're very, very efficient in delivery. So that is what it talks about. There's just some of the stats around Zara. So this is the final thoughts on the VSM. Before we move, any questions on the VSM so far? No? So it says VSM may give you short-term value brights, but improving the process will give you the long-term brightness. So VSM is just not going to improve the efficiency. It is just going to surface where the cycle time is the error proofing, what does it say? So this is again an interesting quote. It says, all in all, coders introduce bugs at the rate of 4.2 defects per hour of programming. They make one mistake for every 7 to 10 lines of code. Almost 1/5 of those errors are simply typos. And if you crack the whip and force people to move more quickly, things will get even more worse. They say there are two kinds of inspections that can take place. Inspection to find defects, which is a waste, as Lean says. But inspection to prevent defects is something which is essential. So it generally tells that we should have tools in place that should inspect early and often rather than towards late in the cycle, right? So it says, what is the role of a QA? The job of a QA is not to swat mosquitoes, but to put up screens so that, you know, things are caught early. So it says errors enters at the start and why to inspect at the end. We need to have continuous inspection. So what can I do over here? I can have coding standards. I can have configuration management, one-click build, continuous integration, automated testing. Automated testing is not just functional testing. It should be a unit testing. A framework should be there, acceptance test, and stop if the test don't pass. This is very important. So at times we do have CI in place. We do have all the unit testing and automation framework in place, but still we say at the time of a release, even if, you know, the build is failing or the defects are there, let's go ahead with it. So I think there you need to have a strong inspection control. So you need to stop if it is not passing. The first priority of any developer or any coder or any team member is to fix that and see, you know, why the build is breaking. Minimum technical depth. So this is all around that. So definition of done, I'm not sure, I think you would have heard in the prior talks as well. It is definitely important, Agile says so. But let me ask you a question. How many of you have definition of done pasted on your whiteboards against your seat? How many of you really refer to it? Or it is just kept as an artifact somewhere in your SharePoint site or something like that? So very, very few of you. I think I just saw 2 or 3 hands. So again, I will say the tools are powerful. They are there. But how the enforcement of that is very important. So definition of done is a very, very powerful tool. But most of the time, what you see is it is generally done as an artifact and done once and kept there just as a tick mark. But that is something that should be ever-changing. It is a live document, right? And it needs to be referred on a daily basis. Or at least on a sprint basis, or whatever, when you are saying this PBI or this product backlog item or this user story is done, are you really referring to your definition of done? Right? So this is very, very important that it should be there. So it says stop the line culture, test before you check in. So TDD is something which is really good, you know, test-driven development, but I think most of us are actually struggling to have a TDD kind of thing. Because generally, developers are, you know, they find a way of doing it. They check in the code and the test together. But rarely are you doing a TDD in true sense. That is important. So I think that is something, again, the cultural thing that we need to bring in. Test early and often. It says every moment, pair by pair programming. Every few minutes, unit test. Every day, acceptance test. Every build submission, your unit tests are going to run. Every week, system test. Every iteration, full regression. So this is something that you need to test early and often. That is fixing BJP. That is the point of this slide. Avoid technical debt. Anything that makes code difficult to change, the usual excuse of badges and queues, complexity or regression deficit, whatever it is, you should try to avoid it. These are the books that I referred for creating these slides. It's Working Effectively with Legacy Code and Fit for Developing Software. Nice books to read if anyone of you wants a more deep dive of things, right? So any questions on error proofing? Error proofing is all around that build a strong testing framework, fix it immediately, test early and often, refer to your definition of done, right? And the job of a QA is not to test at the end, but to put the screen so that the bugs can be caught early, right, in the cycle. So that was all around error proofing. Now it says the next tool I want to talk about is defer commit. Now this is again a very interesting slide. It says pilots are trained to make decisions in the challenging weather situations, right? So before you read further, and again it is not that readable also, when do you feel that the pilot should take a decision on a challenging weather condition?
When the communication breaks.
Yes, so that's the last responsible moment, right? He cannot say that, okay, I the weather forecast is saying after 3 hours there will be a dust storm, so let's not fly, right? Or let's not take off. So that is, I think, that is the point of the last responsible moment. That don't make the decision until that time, and don't make the decision after that time, you know, because that is why, you know, example of a pilot is taken, because that is very, very important, that to decide your last responsible movement. Because generally, you know, when I have seen in the planning meetings at times, especially when the teams start with the agile journey, they spend a lot of time in giving the story point to a task, and a lot of discussion is happening around the story. Is it really needed? Is it really that matters? Right? Or isn't it something that, you know, you give a logical story points and move on, you know, and decide whenever the story comes, and that insight can be used in your next planning meeting, because you're not allowed to change the story points. But that is important, you know, that you need to defer commitments till the last responsible moment. He says a plan is not a commitment, it is a current view. So you need to realize that, you know, it is just a current view of the statement. And generally, you know, when we do the project planning at the initial start of any project, and what is our level of information at that time? Is it the most or it is the least? It is the least at that time. So definitely that plan is going to change, because I have the least information at that point of time, right? So that's what it says. It is just a current view of the thing. So if one sticks to the idea that one said a plan should not be changed, a business cannot exist for long. And in preparing for battle, I have always found that plans are useless, but planning is indispensable. So generally, you don't stick to the plan, but the insight you gain in discussions and, you know, and in talking in your planning meeting is something that is more useful, right? So again, what I said, it says that if plans are commitments, we are committing to decisions made when we are the most ignorant. So, right? And measuring conformance to plan is measuring the wrong thing, because the plan is going to change. So I think you don't know everything, so you should keep your options on, open for business and technical, make decisions reversible wherever possible, or make them at the last responsible moment. That is what it says. Again, there is an exercise which we'll skip. And again, if you can define the plan in terms of customer, that is always the best in case of business scenarios or picks or essentials and candidates. Coming to the next tool, that is the standardized work and visual controls. So what it says? It says define and document the best known method. Make it visual. So how many of us or how many of you are using actually whiteboards or post-its for your sprint backlogs? Excellent. But again, I saw very, very few hands. Again, we know and we have heard in almost all the conferences that it is the best way, you know, a visual dashboard. But generally, we switch back to our tools when we go back to our office. So I think if this is the one thing you want to change, going back, start having visual boards. Even start with the impediment list, I would say. If it is not possible to put all your things on the board, at least start with the impediment list. Put a whiteboard, start writing the impediment. So at least, or the name of a person who is blocked by someone. That is also very powerful, and that is going to help. And if you will see that you start reaping benefits out of it, you will start putting again the post-its, and you will see eventually your sprint backlog is more visual, right? So at least start, I would suggest, with the impediment list. So again, it says what is better, as I already told, is it this thing is more better, like, you know, at a glance, the percentage, or a line graph is better, which is giving you more quick information. So it just says have your information as visual as possible, whether it's a sprint backlogs, put post-its, or whether it is any other information, put it in a graphical form rather than in a tabular form. Because visual controls can be more meaningful, and the information radiators is our best example. Again, it just says what is it, I think you all know. So let's quickly cover the problem we all know the five whys, I think PMP and PMI also say so, but do we use in our day-to-day lives? Do you really use in your things? We don't, right? So that is the, I would say, the funny thing of all this. We generally know. I think I might not be telling a very new thing for you know, many of you. But we don't practice. You know, we go back and we get to our usual ways of doing things. So at least start practicing. Take out, at least you are spending your weekends over here hearing the speakers. At least take two or three things out of these two-day conference that you're going to go back and implement. You're going to change in your project. I think that is going to make better your processes and your knowledge. Until unless we implement, I think five eyes each of us knows already. Yes, sir.
What makes you believe that?
It doesn't make me believe because I am also one amongst you. What I am saying is at least we can try. That's what I am saying, try with smaller things. For example, when I said information radiators, I said at least start with the impediment list. At least make a change of two things that you're going to change in your project. And maybe you deliver, you know, you take something out of my talk or any other speaker's talk, but at least try to change. That is important. Just coming over here, listening to the things is not going to help.
Yeah.
Yes.
One example actually we get. A template we have written one section and the equity analysis is born of YY. One of two ways you can do it. So sometimes the templates can help actually. That you force them to do that.
I think if you are going to change, you know, you definitely act as a catalyst for someone else. Because otherwise, you know, it is a chain reaction, I would say. So if we are going to change one thing, definitely, you know, you will see your other team member following the same thing the other day.
What's not clear to me is that what's the value of it? Even if we create a template and... No, value is like you can find the root cause analysis to the why analysis, why analysis.
Yeah.
Let's
look at the example. It is very, very fine example. The system test failure, why it failed. Different versions of acceptance criteria. Why? No standard set of criteria, but we never ask so many whys because we assume why in our day-to-day life, you know.
I have used at least 100.
And it is a very common thing. I'm not saying nothing new, but it is very powerful. But the fact is just we never reach to five why at any point of time. Even in our personal life, I think just go back and try to analyze. You assume. You know, this would have been wrong. You never use five whys, you know. But at least try using it and you will see it is very powerful as you are teling. I mean, I have seen practically. It is definitely a very, very powerful tool and very simple as well.
Normally this happens when the escalation has already been done.
Yeah.
So if we do this, probably we can save the escalation.
From my experience, I'm sharing, at least 100 cases I have seen this has given tremendous value. Of course, in the 16 of the cases also, good technique used.
Okay, so I think I'm just, you know, few more slides then because the time is there. It just talks about, I think we all know about it. So that is the problem. Sorry, we use any other fishbone or anything. But the idea is use some tool, at least, for this analysis. The other is learning and continuous improvement. It says how you can do it, regular work team meetings, database problem analysis. You should not guess, find and analyze the data. That is important. And solve one problem. I think retrospectives, again, are a very good example. We find out, you know, we took out a lot of things, but we take top two or top three that is disturbing the most of the team. So that is important. And actively enable learning. It is all about learning and continuous development. This capturing knowledge concisely, use as few words as possible. Generally, you know, whatever it can pictorially depict it is the best way. That is what it is. So I think that is all around, you know, the tools that we talked about. So we talked about VSM, error proofing, defer commitment, standardized work and visual controls, problem solving, learning and continuous improvement. And they're all very powerful in their own way. I would suggest that even if you implement any one of them or any two of them, you are definitely going to see a change. You're definitely going to see an improvement. Or even apply VSM to your work as well. You know, you can do a VSM for one day at work. What do you do? Where exactly your time is going? At times we say time management, you know, this is always an issue that we have so much of work, don't have time for it, or don't have time to do any personal thing. Try doing a VSM for you first, I would say. You will see where exactly, you know, the time is going. Maybe it is the time you spend in cab, maybe it's the time you spend, and maybe you find something where you can do, you know. So that is all, you know, from me. These are the references again for Lean. You can refer to copentic.com and find out more things. So I, with that, I open the questions. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.